What's going on, guys? In this video, we're going to talk about the main characteristics of GraphQL. What are the differences between GraphQL and REST? We're going to review the GraphQL architecture and some examples on how to use it. So let's get started. GraphQL is an open source query and manipulation language for APIs and a runtime for fulfilling queries with existing data. It was developed by Facebook and released in 2015. And GraphQL allows you to ask for specific data, giving clients more control over what information is sent. And this is one of the main differences between GraphQL and REST APIs. Now let's see a comparison between GraphQL and REST. In GraphQL, you ask for what you need and you're going to get exactly that. While in REST, there is an all or nothing approach. Just to give an example, let's say that we have a user resource that includes the user ID, first name, and last name. If we want to get a list that only includes the user ID, in GraphQL, we are able to create a query and we're going to get exactly what we want. If we use REST, we need to fetch the entire resource, including user ID, first name, and last name. So in other words, and moving on to the second row, in GraphQL, the server declares what resources are available, and the client asks for what it needs. In REST, the shape and the size of the resource is defined by the server. In GraphQL, we are able to get multiple resources in a single request using a query, while in REST, we need to make multiple requests to fetch data from multiple resources. In GraphQL, the actions are defined by a mutation or a query, while in REST, the actions are defined by the URL and the HTTP method. In GraphQL, you only have one endpoint, while in REST, you have multiple endpoints. So this means that in REST, you can leverage the HTTP specification for caching using URLs as the unique identifier of a resource. Now let's see some common characteristics between GraphQL and REST APIs. GraphQL and REST work with HTTP and have the idea of a resource to describe data structures. Also, both can fetch data via an HTTP GET request with a URL, and both can return JSON data in the response. Here is a basic architecture diagram where we have a GraphQL client and a server. The GraphQL client will be able to send HTTP requests, including queries, mutations, or subscriptions. We're going to see what they are and some examples in a minute. And the GraphQL server is going to process those requests using a resolver. And this resolver will get the data from a database or a REST API, for example. And then the GraphQL server is going to return a result back to the GraphQL client, typically using a JSON format. Okay, so we've been talking about queries, mutations, subscriptions, and results. Now let's see how we can specify the structure of those elements using GraphQL schemas. A GraphQL service defines a set of types or schema, which completely describes the set of possible data you can query on that service. And that schema includes data types, queries, mutations, and subscriptions for push notifications. The schema is written by using the GraphQL schema language. Here we have an example of an schema where we have a video and a user data types. We also have a query that returns a list of videos. We have a mutation to create new videos using a new video input. And we have a subscription to get a push notification when a new video is created. Okay, so what is a query in GraphQL? A query is used to read or fetch values, and GraphQL queries run in parallel. Let's see an example of a query that could be performed by a GraphQL client. In this case, we have a find videos query that is going to fetch the title and the URL of the video and the last name of the author. Okay, let's talk a little bit about mutations. A mutation can be used to insert, update, or delete data and returns a value. Mutations run in series. This means that if we send two create video mutations in one request, the first is guaranteed to finish before the second begins. Let's see an example of a mutation. Here we have a mutation named create video, and we pass the title, the URL, and the identifier of the author for that video. And as a result, we expect the identifier of the author, the title, and the URL of the video. In the next video, we're going to create a project in order to build a GraphQL server in Golang. That's all for now. Thank you for watching. Remember to subscribe to the channel, and I see you in the next video. Take care. Bye.